What's happening, family? It's time to pray. And in our evening time, we've got one thought, one driving mantra that we want to leave on your heart and allow to just arrest your attention and bridle your conscience. Don't stop praying. The emphasis that I want to look at on this evening is out of Exodus chapter 14, a familiar narrative to us, and the story of the Red Sea crossing, but one that really grabs a number of principles about prayer out of the text. Listen to it, verse number 13. But Moses said to the people, "Do not fear. Stand by and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will accomplish for you today. For the Egyptians whom you have seen today, you will never see them again forever. The Lord will fight for you while you keep silent." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Why are you crying out to me? What you praying about? Tell the sons of Israel to go forward. As for you, lift up your staff, stretch out your hand over the sea and divide it, and the sons of Israel shall go through the midst of the sea on dry land. As for me, behold, I will harden the hearts of Pharaoh, the hearts of the Egyptians, so that they will go in after them, and I will be honored through Pharaoh and all his army, through his chariots and his horsemen. Then the Egyptians will know that I am the Lord when I am honored through Pharaoh, through his chariots and his horsemen." Powerful story, and you know this narrative well. Many of us have read it numbers of times, and we're familiar with how God moves in the text. But this passage brings a number of things that speak to our spirit and remind us why we should never stop praying, why we should hear the word of the scripture teach us, don't stop praying. At least three things. Number one, don't stop praying because prayer practically brings God into your crisis. You remember this narrative. God had gone toe-to-toe with the nation of Egypt. And he faced Pharaoh back to back with 10 plagues. Now they're out and they're on their way into the Canaan land promise that God said he was going to give them. And while they're on the way, Pharaoh's heart had been hardened. He makes the decision, creates an entire alliance with his entire nation. They all come out in pursuit of the children of Israel. Here you have about 2 million ex-slaves. They don't know how to fight. All they've known how to do is make brick and serve and cater to the Egyptians. And they're in pursuit. They're being pursued by these Egyptians who don't want to let them go. Isn't it interesting at times how the things that you want to say goodbye to, the things that you want to let go out of your life, how you said bye to Satan, who is your type of Pharaoh. You said bye to sinfulness, that is your type of Egypt. You said goodbye to your vices, which is your type of form of service. You're letting it go and you're out and on your way. But isn't it interesting how many times those things will pursue you? And life has a way. Life has a way of dynamically putting you in a place of crisis where when you are making a move to get out and do and be who God will call you to be, crisis comes upon you. The people of God, right in this text, were in a situation where they had enemies behind them. They were out in this area moving and they did not know where they were going. They looked forward and all they could see was an ending to their path, the Red Sea. They looked to their right, they looked to their left, and all they could see is emptiness beside them, the desert. And that's exactly how life treats you. Some crisis can make you feel like you're in a corner, trapped, threatened by the certainty of death. And that's the very moment when, like the people of God, you and I must remember to look up to see who's always been ahead of you, always been above you. God was right there. God was near. God noticed. And God is willing to be invited into the situation. So in like fashion, you and I have to practice the mentality that I will not stop praying. In fact, I'm going to keep pushing because prayer invites God into my crisis. But then number two, don't stop praying because prayer
powerfully brings God into the circumstance. Not only is God involved in the crisis, but practically God, or powerfully rather, God is brought into the circumstance. I love this narrative. You go back and read it in its entirety. What you find is that while they were being pursued, God does this amazing thing. He tells Moses, he basically tells him to buck up. Remember what I told you. Go forward. You're going to go forward. You're going to do what you're going to do. You're going to use the staff that I gave you. You're going to pass it over the water, part the Red Sea, and you all will walk over on dry land. Now, that's what he says to him in a nutshell. But what we see is that while they were being pursued, God allows the people of Israel to pause in the middle of their panic, and he gives them a peaceful night's rest. You go back and read it. They are given a peaceful night's rest. They're in pursuit. The pillar of God that was ahead of them removes itself, goes behind them, and is in between the pursuing Pharaoh and the people of God, so that all that night, Pharaoh couldn't get to the people of God, and the people of God could sit back and have a peaceful night's rest. Please don't miss the point. When you know God is your God and fighting for you, God can put whatever's pursuing you on pause. He can put anything that's coming after you on pause. He can literally make things wait. Now watch, while you are waiting in slumber, God is working by allowing his winds to blow through the waters. You see in the text that all that night, the text says a strong east wind cut through the Red Sea. What was that wind doing? The wind was a form of an angel. Go back and look at Hebrews chapter 1. And you find in Hebrews chapter 1 that God's angels are ministering spirits, winds and flames of fire sent forth to minister to them who shall be heirs of the kingdom. So all that night, that strong east wind, the angelic work of God was moving, cutting through the Red Sea, stacking water on top of itself, drying out the water in the path so that the people of God could cross over on dry land. Now, while God was working, they were slumbering. While God was stacking up water, they were sleeping. While God was preparing the path for them, they were able to be at peace. Listen to me. You never have any idea how God is actively working to pave the way for you by day as you're able to trust him in rest at peace at night. Let God work and continue to know that the reason why I pray to him is because God wants to be powerfully involved in all of my circumstances. I dare you. Give him whatever it is you're worried about. Give him whatever it is you're disturbed about. Give him all of your trouble. Give him your finances. Give him your relationships. Give him your health. Give him your family. Give him your stressors. Give him your job. Give him that coworker. Give him that neighbor. Give him the situation that we're in. Give him the season. And what you'll find is that when you give it over to God, God will allow you to put your panic on pause, give you some peace, and you can rest while he goes to work mending what you cannot mend, separating what you cannot separate, stacking what you don't know how to stack, drying up what you can't dry up, so that you can walk through on dry ground, knowing that it's because of your God you've got victory over your moment. Give it to God. Don't stop praying, because prayer practically brings God into your crisis. Prayer powerfully brings God into your circumstances. But let me give you one more thing. Prayer personally brings God into your covenant agreement. I love in the text, I gotta at least read this one to you, where God says over and over again to Moses and the people of Israel, he says it in verse 14, the Lord said, I will fight. The Lord will fight for you while you keep silent. He says in another place in the chapter, the enemy that you see today, you will see no more, never again. I will fight for you. Notice what God is promising us. When you invite God in, when we usher God in to do what only God can do, God will personally give you the covenant agreement that I will fight for you. Whatever you're up against, God speaking, I'm up against. Whatever your enemy is, it's my enemy. Whatever your issue is, it's my issue. Whatever your struggle is, it's my struggle. I will take up the plight with you. You will not go through this alone. So God becomes the one who will, by covenant, partner and walk with you through all of the issues of your life. So don't stop praying. Don't stop praying because God practically is invited into your crisis. Don't stop praying because God powerfully comes into your circumstances. Don't stop praying because God personally will take up the covenant agreement and fight for you. Let's invite him to do just that even right now. Father, we love you. We thank you and we bless you for being our God. We thank you for the reminders that you give us in scripture on how faithful you are to us, how amazing you are, and how you're willing to be involved in our life in a very practical way. God, we thank you for what you've given us and shown us through the pages of inspiration, how the people of Israel, the nation of Israel, were able to trust in you, how you made a vow to them even way back then that you were right there above them while all of life was going on around them. Help us to know, Father, when our stresses seem to be ahead of us and we don't see a way forward, when the issues are behind us and we can't turn back, when there seems to be no hope beside us and all we see is desert-like resolve. Help us to know that you are above us, you are beneath us, you have us insulated. You are the God that we can call on, rely on, and trust on. You are the God who not only will come in and practically, Lord God, be a part of our crisis, but you will powerfully, Lord, fight the issues that we're dealing with. We thank you for allowing us to have peace, allowing us to have rest in our panic moments, in our pandemic moments. You give us the ability to rest knowing that you will send the winds, you will send your angels, you will send our strength, you will send whatever's necessary to fight what we cannot fight, deal with what we cannot deal with, and bless us to have sweet sleep while you work on our behalf. We honor you, we praise you, we know we're not deserving, but we bless you in the name of our King. And Father, we thank you even right now for choosing to covenant with us, so know that we don't have to go through this thing alone. We thank you, Father, for being willing to heal, strengthen, and deliver, to be willing to insulate and protect, to be willing to change hearts and lives and minds, to be willing to inspire those that need and have to have your ingenuity to make it through these challenges. We call on your power. We need you, Lord God. We trust you to be our God. Keep us safe. Keep us secured. Keep us standing for your name's sake. Keep your people aligned so that they're talking to you on a regular basis. Give us a spirit that simply says we will not stop praying and reaching out to you. We will not give up. We need you every moment of every day that you grant us to have. And so we ask that you bless us even right now. We ask all this in Jesus' name as we together say amen and amen. Let me challenge you again. Don't stop praying. Your God wants to practically be involved in your crisis. Your God wants to powerfully be ushered into your circumstances. And your God wants to personally bring you a covenant agreement that whatever you fight, he fights it with you. I'm going to pray for you. I'm asking you, please pray for me. And let's watch our God change everything around us. God bless you and God keep you.
When I'm busy, when I have things to do.